Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Heavenly Father, we know your word says you will never leave us or forsake us. You are our rock of ages, and we can always call on you in times of trouble. Lord, help us to realize that you are with us during times of trials and tribulations. Give us the strength and faith to call on your name when we feel helpless and vulnerable. Loving Father, you have been our comforter in times of trouble, our peace in times of distress, and our shelter from the storms of life. You are the great physician, teacher, provider, and all of our help comes from you. Lord, you are everything to us, and without you, we are nothing. Use us, Lord, as mediums through which your love flows out to others. Gracious God, we give you thanks for all the people you have put in our lives over the years, including those within the past year who we have never seen but have embraced as sisters and brothers via the internet. We thank you for the daily blessings bestowed on us. We pray, Lord, that your purpose for us will be fulfilled in and through your mighty name. Lord, may each step we make lead us closer to you. Help us to walk by your word and not by our feelings. Help us to keep our hearts pure and focused on you. Help us to rebuke the enemy when disruptive ideas, doubts, and other negative thoughts come into our minds. Keep us from being distracted by our own selfish wants and desires. Heavenly Father, help us to lay aside anything and everything that hinders our spiritual progress or inhibits our witness for you. Lord, please forgive us our sins, whether deliberate or unknowingly, and help us to live in your light. Dear Lord, we know that we are not fighting against a physical enemy, but an evil and powerful spiritual enemy. Give us the spiritual strength to help us realize the importance of covering ourselves completely in the whole armor of God, so that we are spiritually prepared and equipped to stand firm against any evil when it comes. Lord, we know you will always take care of your people, so there is no need for us to be worried, anxious, or afraid. We continue to ask you to keep us strong in your faith. We ask all these things through our precious Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The Old Testament lesson is taken from 2 Kings chapter 2, reading from verse 1 to verse 12. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went, and stood at some distance from them as they were both standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up, and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen!" But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. This is the word of the Lord. Thank you.
This evening we are meditating on the theme, when silence is golden, when silence is golden. And as I greet you in the precious name of our Lord and the Savior Jesus Christ, it is my prayer that this meditation would inspire as well as bless us all. Now in our reading, Elijah and Elisha are together, and God is about to take Elijah into heaven. Elisha refuses to leave Elijah and accompanies him wherever God sent him. He wanted from Elijah a double portion of his spirit. Elisha wanted to savor every last moment with his friend to the very end of his earthly journey. Three sets of prophets tried to discourage Elisha, but each time his response to them was, "Be silent. Be silent." I am sure that there are some persons in your life to whom you always want to say, "Shut up. You're talking too much. Be silent. Be quiet." I'm certain that if I were to ask you to name one character in the Bible who fits that bill, you would have no difficulty in answering. Yes, I am hearing you all loud and clear. Simon Peter. He was the person. Now, one cannot deny the fact that Peter has been credited with very sound and meaningful utterances. Like when Jesus asked the disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" His declaration, "You are the Messiah, Son of the Living God," brought this response from Jesus in Matthew chapter 16 and verse 17. "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this unto you, but my Father who is in heaven. You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church." It is Peter's declaration, not Peter himself, which is the rock, the foundation on which the church of Jesus Christ is built. I just want to make one observation, and that is that Jesus was calling him Simon all the time, but now, after this declaration, Jesus felt he could be upgraded, as we say. So he changed his name to Peter. And you know, this happens all the time in the Bible. We saw it with Abraham, who was called Abraham after, and Sarai was called Sarah, and Saul was Paul after a change of character. So now, Simon, son of Jonah, is Peter. Now we also remember in Acts chapter 2, when the disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit and they began to speak in tongues. Of course, all the onlookers, all the listeners were amazed, but there were some who were critical, even to the point of being nasty. And they said, "What happened? These people, like, they're drunk. It's nearly 9 o'clock in the morning and they're drunk already." But of course, Peter had the answer. Peter got up and he said, "No, these people are not drunk. We're not drunk, as you think, but we are filled with the Holy Spirit." And so he told them about Joel. Remember Joel chapter 2 and verse 28, when Joel said, when Joel is prophesying what God would do, "I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams." However, Peter was the one who always spoke out of turn. As I said, he was smart, yes, but there are some times that he acted very foolish. For instance, when the disciples were told by Jesus, you know, Jesus was trying to tell them about what he was going to have to undergo, all his suffering and so on. And Peter now felt he had to say something. He tried to sidetrack Jesus from what he was saying. And he said, "No, Master, this would never happen to you." You know, Jesus, remember what Jesus said? Jesus said, well, he actually called him, he equated him with Satan. But you see, Peter, as smart as he was, as intelligent and as, you know, forthright, well, he was, sometimes he's too forthright. It, you know, it looked as though he sometimes used to talk first and then think after. You see? I remember hearing a saying, wise men speak because they have something to say. Fools speak because they want to say something. Now, I don't like the idea of calling Peter a fool, eh? But that is how we got on sometimes. He spoke foolishness, and it probably because he was very impulsive. That is was his character. Very, very impulsive. Now, another example. Now, remember the maid in the Garden of Gethsemane accused Peter of being with Jesus. She said, "You are one of them." Now, she didn't really expect an answer because everybody knew. But Peter felt he had to say something. He said, no, I don't know him. I don't know the man. But of course, scripture must be fulfilled. And at the Last Supper, was it? When Jesus was with the disciples and he said to them, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me thrice." So scripture had to be fulfilled. And here Peter was talking out of turn. He was talking very, you know, as though he was very foolish. His silence here would also have been golden. Now the third example. Now in Mark chapter 9, at the transfiguration of Jesus, he just had to say something. It was Jesus, Elijah, and Moses. And Peter said, "Lord, let us make three dwellings. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He spoke out of turn. And as a matter of fact, verse 6 of that very gospel, Mark chapter 9, says of Peter, he did not know what to say. You see, as I said, Peter felt he had to say something, but he didn't know what to say. So the word just came out. Peter was no fool, but sometimes maybe because of his impulsive character, as I said before, he acted like one. And my dear listeners, this is what happens when we act without consulting Holy Spirit, which guides us into all truth. We think, say, and do foolish things sometimes if we do not consult with the Holy Spirit. We should consult regularly to know when to speak and when to be silent. Many of the tragedies of our nation as well as of the world would have been and can be avoided if people would just say nothing. And it happens in our daily lives, you know. You might find two people arguing. And, you know, one must have the last word, of course. So, instead of you know, stopping, one of them just, well, both of them continue. But if one of them would even stop, that might be the end, you know. But they go on arguing. Nobody wants to be quiet. And what is the result? Homicide. Murder. It happens all the time. But the silent treatment very often works, you know. You try talking to somebody and they just ignore you. They're just not just answering you. And you really feel foolish. You know, sometimes when someone is talking, when you're talking to someone and, oh, sorry, when someone is talking to you, making a point, you know, and maybe, you know, get coming down on you. And you just decide not to say a word. Yeah, the person say, "Oh, so you're ignoring me." Not ignoring, and you're ignoring me. But this silent treatment is good. Silence is very often golden. Now, a lot can be learned when people are silent and listen. Luke 24 has the incident of the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. They listened, Jesus joined them, and they listened to him, and they learned a lot. Now, this should be a lesson to us, even as we pray. We should not do all the talking. Too many of us just talk nonstop. We ask Jesus for this, we ask him for that, we ask him for the other. We just go on and on and on. And Jesus cannot even get in a word, as I say, in edgewise. Our prayers are selfish. But if we just listen as we pray, we sometimes hear his voice, not only telling us what to do, not only answering our prayer then, but sometimes he's telling us what he wants us to do for him. But we are too busy with our own wants and desires to hear him speaking to us. We have to remember, I remember we had a song when I was a child saying, I can't remember the song itself, but I know it said, Christ has no hands but our hands. So that Christ needs us to listen to him and to hear what he wants us to do for him. Now as I close, I refer to the voice of God at the Transfiguration, which said, this is my beloved son, listen to him. Here again, silence is golden. Then as Jesus and the disciples were returning to the plains, he reminded them that silence is golden, because he swore them to secrecy. He said, don't say anything about what you saw or what you heard until after the resurrection. So my challenge to you, my dear listeners, as to myself, is not to be too quick to talk. On our own, we would say the first thing that comes to our mind. However, we should make it a point of duty to consult Holy Spirit in all we think, say, and do, so that we will continue to glorify God in all the earth, according to Revelation chapter 4 and verse 11. That is the main reason for which we were created. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
guard your steps when you go to the house of God. To draw near to listen is better than the sacrifice offered by fools, for they do not know how to keep from doing evil. Never be rash with your mouth, nor let your heart be quick to utter a word before God. For God is in heaven and you upon earth, therefore let your words be few. For dreams come with many cares, and a fool's voice with many words. When you make a vow to God, do not delay in fulfilling it, for he has no pleasure in fools. Fulfill what you vow. It is better that you should not vow than that you should vow and not fulfill it. Do not let your mouth lead you into sin, and do not say before the messenger that it was a mistake. Why should God be angry at your words and destroy the work of your hands? With many dreams come vanities and a multitude of words, but fear God. And now, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Amen.
We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to his word, and may it dwell in all of us richly.